Dental Sciences, Hyderabad, and as a senior lecturer for 1 year at Annur Dental College, Moottipuzha. Of the various presentations done by Dr. Sangeeta, she has secured Best Faculty Paper Presentation Award in the 43rd Indian Prosthodontic Society Conference in the year 2015. She has her work published in numerous national and international journals. She is married to Dr. Prem Anand, MDS Oral and Maxillofacial Surgeon, who is currently practicing in Chennai, and is blessed with a daughter, Pranita. Currently, she is working as a dental officer in ECHS Polyclinic, Changanashery. On behalf of Tiruvalla IDA, Dr. Sangeeta, I welcome you for the webinar on post-COVID.
Thank you. Okay, doctor, if you're ready, you can start.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
So, yeah. Good evening to all, and welcome to today's webinar on porcelain veneers. Now, we all have heard about porcelain veneers. So, we all know that porcelain veneers are very thin bonded ceramic restoration that restores the labial surface as well as part of the proximal surface of teeth requiring aesthetic restoration. Now, veneers, we know that there are direct veneers and indirect veneers. Direct veneers are one which we frequently do in our clinics also with composite restoration. And indirect veneers are the one which are made by the ceramist in the dental lab. So today's webinar, we'll discuss about the indirect veneer, which is bonded, that is, there is adhesive bonding, and it's an all ceramic restoration. It is partial coverage, that is, it will not cover the entire tooth surface. It will only cover the labial surface and part of the partial proximal surface of the tooth. So what are the advantages of indirect veneers over direct veneers? Because when we are preparing multiple teeth, we'll have to spend a lot of time if we do a direct veneer, that is through composite. So, and when we do an indirect veneer also, it is less sensitive to operator technique because all the restorations will look alike. And if multiple teeth are to be veneered, we will save our time. And as compared to direct veneer, indirect veneers will last much longer because it has very good translucency, it has good strength. So, and because also it is resistant to staining, so the longevity of this kind of indirect veneer is much longer than the direct veneers. Now, before we do a veneer for any patient, we should know how to select a proper case for veneer. So for this, before we discuss the case selection, we know that there are four philosophies of aesthetic dentistry. That is, we try to correct any anesthetic tooth through recoloring. That is, if it is discolored, we'll go for bleaching. If the tooth is not positioned correctly, we can do orthodontic treatment. If the tooth can be corrected aesthetically through recontouring, we'll go for enameloplasty. And if we cannot get a good aesthetic result through all three of these, then we'll go to restore the teeth through composite, veneer, or crown. So when we are going to select a case for veneer, we should see that the occlusion is good. That is, it is a balanced and aligned occlusion. And veneer is indicated in such cases where there is discolored tooth, where there is multiple discolored teeth because of tetracycline fluoride, where there is enamel defects or multiple teeth with spacing, diastema, microdontia, malformed teeth, any teeth that involves buccal caries, and all of this in a good occlusion. So the contraindications where we should not consider giving a veneer for the patient is when there is no enamel present on the teeth. So when there is insufficient coronal tooth structure, less than half of coronal tooth structure, in that case, we cannot give a veneer. We'll go for a crown because we cannot give more than 2 mm of vertical cantilever with a veneer. And when the patient has parafunctional habits such as bruxism, edge-to-edge bite, in that case also, the veneer will have a poor prognosis. In cases where there is insufficient or inadequate enamel for sufficient retention, for example, there is severe abrasion or severe fluorosis, in teeth exhibiting severe crowding, because then tooth preparation and positioning of veneers become difficult. And in patients with periodontal disease, and also we will not give veneer for children, because children have actively erupting permanent teeth. So these are the contraindications for veneer. So whenever we do a case selection for veneer, it is very important that we see the occlusion, and we have to see whether adequate amount of enamel is present. So whenever we go for veneer treatment, it is very important to have a trilateral communication between the patient, technician, and dentist. So the dentist and patient should have a mutual agreement on the aesthetic final outcome that we are going to receive. Only after that, the dentist will convey it to the technician. So this trilateral communication is very important to have a good indirect restoration. So before we start the clinical procedure, it is very, very important to make a primary impression for diagnostic cast models. We'll have to do a bite or jaw relation so that we can send it to the technician. He can also see the occlusion of the patient so that he knows. Excuse me. Yeah, excuse me. So it is very important to take bite or jaw relations. Oh my God, just a second. Just excuse me for a moment. Yeah, so sorry for the interruption. So before we start the clinical procedure, it is very important to make impressions so that we can have a diagnostic cast. It's important to take bite or jaw relation so that we can transfer this bite to the technician also, so that he can also see where the junction of the veneer and tooth should end. The junction should not be in the region of functional contact area. So this is also very important. Then we have to do shade selection before we start the tooth preparation. And we have to record the patient's profile through digital photography or videos. After all this only, we should start our treatment planning. And then we'll go to mock-up. So after we've made our diagnostic cast, we've recorded photographs, and we've sent it to the lab, we can now do the treatment planning. Like if you see in this case, the central incisors do not have more than half of coronal tooth structure. So in that this case, we can decide that the central incisors will not go for veneer, they will go for a crown. The laterals will go for veneer, and the canines can also go for veneer, or if it is possible through enameloplasty, we can recontour it. And through treatment planning, we can also see whether we have symmetrical gingival architecture. Suppose patient has a high lip line and he has a symmetrical gingival architecture, then we can do crown lengthening, or we can call a periodontist. Or if the teeth are not aligned properly, the teeth are too much lingually inclined or are labially inclined, in that case, we will call an orthodontist to do orthodontic correction before we start our preparation for veneer. So in this stage, we'll do a treatment planning. We'll check the smile line, lip line, gingival architecture, and then we'll go for a diagnostic wax-up. So diagnostic wax-up is very important. It is very similar to test drive that we do before buying a car. So it is shows us what the final result will be. So this is a very, very important step, because not only it can convince the patient, so guided. So do a diagnostic wax up. Now, when we want to do diagnostic wax up, it means we are going to add wax on the diagnostic cast as it will be on the patient's mouth. So there are two types of diagnostic wax up that we'll go for. One is the additive case, the other is the subtractive case. So the additive case, in this case, we can see that we can see the surface of the occlusal view of the cast that the central incisors are lingually placed. So in this case, we do not require to trim the cast in order to give veneer to the patient, or we need not trim the teeth in this case because the centrals are already lingually placed. So what we will do, we'll add the wax on the diagnostic cast without trimming the cast. There's no need to trim the cast because the teeth are already slightly lingually inclined. So this, after we do diagnostic mock-up, that is we add the wax on the diagnostic cast, we will now replicate this on our putty index. So we use putty silicon impression material to record this diagnostic wax up. And we will make a additive mock-up. By adding provisional material, we can add protemp plus bisacryl, and we'll place this in the patient's mouth. So here, whatever result achieved, it in patient's mouth. So it is the best for the patient. If the patient sees it and he likes his smile, he likes the appearance of his teeth, he asks you to go ahead with treatment. So it is helpful for the patient also to see the final outcome of the result. And it's also helpful for the dentist also to see how the final restoration will look like. So this was additive case when there was no need to reduce any amount of tooth structure, or there was no need to trim the cast. Now there is subtractive case. Subtractive case is the one when you view the cast through occlusal view and you find that some of the teeth are rotated or some of the teeth are not properly aligned. Either they are labially placed. So in this case, we will go for aesthetic pre-recontouring, which is that we will correct, which means that we will correct the tooth position or their alignment. So as you can see in this picture, the central incisor here, the left central incisor is overlapping the right central incisor. So from the occlusal view, we can check how the teeth are aligned by placing an orthodontic arch wire. So in this picture, we can see that we have placed an orthodontic arch wire, and we can see that the central incisor here is slightly labially aligned. So then that means that we'll have to trim this part. So the part which is projecting out of this arch will be trimmed. This is called a subtractive mock-up, because we know that the tooth that is labially positioned will have to be trimmed so that we can bring it back to the proper alignment. So in this case, we will add wax to the cast after trimming that labially inclined tooth in the cast. So after this, we'll have to reduce the tooth in the patient's mouth also. Otherwise, the putty index that we made through the diagnostic wax is not going to fit in the patient's mouth. So the tooth structure that we have removed in the cast, same amount of tooth structure need to be removed in the patient's mouth also. And this will be done only in cases when the teeth is not too much labially inclined. Because in that case, if we reduce the tooth, that is going to expose the dentin. So there's no point giving veneer when you don't have sufficient amount of enamel. So it is very important that we see whether we need an orthodontist before we go for veneer. If the teeth is inclined more than 2 millimeter, it's better to call an orthodontist and align it first before we do veneer preparation. So after reducing this tooth, the putty index is going to sit passively. There will be space for you to add now temporaries so that the patient can see how it will look in the mouth. So this is how we have made putty index that we had made through the mock-up. We are going to add temporary material over here and we are going to transfer it in the patient's mouth. Now that we have already transferred the mock-up or the temporary in the patient's mouth, we will start a tooth preparation through this temporary. So this is called as guided tooth preparation. So now we'll start the tooth preparation part. So when we do tooth preparation, we have to keep in mind about two things. One is volumetric reduction. Second is preparation geometry. So volumetric reduction means whether we have created proper amount of space for the restoration or not. So for this also, we should have done a diagnostic wax up and we should have made a putty index. For this, you should send the diagnostic cast to the technician so that he only can prepare the putty index and send it back to you. So that when you do the tooth preparation, you can keep the putty index in the patient's mouth and check whether you have done uniform reduction on all the teeth and whether you have given space for the restoration. So this is dual technique, which means we will do tooth preparation through the mock-up. So here the temporaries are placed in the mouth and we will use depth cut burr and we'll start preparing teeth through this depth cut burrs. So here we have prepared the labial surface and this will be the final outcome. We'll remove all the temporary material that was placed on the tooth. After this, we move on to the preparation geometry, which means we'll check the path of insertion. There should not be any undercut. Margins should be located properly. The margin design, rounding of internal line angles, all this should be taken care of in the preparation geometry. So this is the armamentarium which we require for tooth preparation. That is, we need a tapered round end burr. We need depth cutting burrs, 0.5 mm, 0.3 mm. We need Optra gate for tooth isolation. We need ceramic polishers, an IPR strip or needle burr. So this is an Optra gate and this is Eve dipole twist polisher, which we can use to polish the ceramic or the tooth. Now, before we start the tooth preparation, the first step is we will select the shade of tooth that we are going to prepare and we'll also match it with the adjacent tooth. So it is very important that before starting tooth preparation, we will select the shade of the tooth and we'll take photograph also with that shade. Now we know that tooth preparation of veneer is of four types. There is window, feather edge, incisal butt joint, bevel, or there is lingual overlap. But this one, that is the incisal butt joint, is proven to be most successful in most of the cases because it does not interfere with the occlusal contact. Now we have done a diagnostic through the technician. We have asked him to make a putty. We have done the treatment planning. We mock up and the patient has given us a green signal. Now we'll start the tooth preparation. So we'll first prepare the labial surface. So as you can see here in the diagram, the labial surface of the central incisor is convex. And we are taught in our textbooks that when we do tooth preparation for a crown, the labial surface is prepared in two planes. So in this case, we can prepare it in multiple planes or we can prepare it in three planes, that is cervical, middle, and the incisal. Why? Because here the path of insertion is labiolingual. It is not in the along the long axis of the tooth as in the case of a crown. So since the path of insertion is labiolingual, we are just attaching the veneer directly on the tooth surface. So in this case, the tooth preparation will be in multiple planes. That is, we will prepare the cervical part. The cervical part needs to be prepared only 0.3 mm because it is shown through studies that the enamel in the cervical region is very, very thin. So that is why we'll do only 0.3 millimeter of preparation. In the rest of the part, we can increase the thickness to 0.6 mm. So now we will go for depth cutting. So depth cutting has to be in three planes. As you can see, we have used depth cut burrs. So 0.5 mm depth cut burrs will be used in the middle third and 0.3 mm depth cut burr will be used in the incisal part. So there are three horizontal depth cuts are prepared in the labial surface. So once we prepare the labial surface,
sound.
Hello. Hello.
Aglish doctor.
Doctor. Not audible.
His line has got cut, I think, but it's still working.
Yeah. I'll just ask, sir.
Just call.
Revi, audible, alle.
I'll put it here, sir. Okay.
Hello.
Sir, I have informed you that today. I just informed Dr. Sangeeta.
Okay. Sorry for the interruption. I think our speaker's line got cut. Doctor, can you hear us? Can you hear us?
Yes, sir.
I think your connection is a bit weak. I think that's why. Okay, anyway, you can carry on. We can see it. We can see the slides.
I finished up till, I think I was...
You finished
from
that
where
also.
Should I continue, sir?
You finished that slide also. Next slide.
Incisal edge?
Yeah.
Yeah, I was discussing incisal edge reduction.
Yeah.
Yes, I'll continue with this.
Okay.
So after we've done the labial preparation, we will begin incisal edge reduction. So incisal edge reduction, we will reduce incisal edge to 1 to 1.5 mm. As I've mentioned already, it helps in positive seating. It increases incisal translucency and it is stronger also. So we'll do a butt joint preparation incisally, and we can check how much tooth we have prepared to the party index that we had made before starting preparation. So incisal edge reduction, one is the butt joint, the other type is the lingual wrap. In this case, we will cover the lingual surface also partially. This is indicated only when you feel that the amount of enamel is not adequate on the labial aspect. Otherwise, incisal butt joint is enough with the current amount of adhesive cements that we have. So the advantage of wrapping on the lingual surface is that it prevents tooth flexion and it also provides additional bonding surface. But there is disadvantage also, because when we cover the lingual surface of the tooth structure, we are limiting our path of insertion. Because when the tooth structure is covered only on the labial aspect, it's easier to position the veneer on the tooth surface than when the veneer covers the lingual surface as well. There can be more chances of discrepancy in this case, as it will be difficult to place the veneer on the tooth. Now, we'll prepare the margin. We've done the labial reduction through depth cut burrs. We have done the incisal reduction and we'll give a proper margin. Now, margin are given in the margins are given in the cervical area where the thickness of enamel is very less. So we have to keep it in mind that we cannot go as deep through the burr as we can go in the incisal or the middle portion of the tooth. So we can reduce a tooth structure only to maximum 0.3 millimeter. So we have to be very careful in this region since the enamel is less. Now we know that there are three types of margin designs. There is supragingival margin, equigingival and subgingival margin. And supragingival margin is preferred in most cases because it is more, it helps in good periodontal health. And also because making impression is easy, you can easily make temporary, the cementation, everything becomes easy with supragingival margins. But supragingival margins have a limitation in the maxillary anterior region where the junction of veneer and tooth can be visible. So in this case, it is good if we can go 0.5 millimeter subgingivally. We can do it by placing a retraction cord. Retraction cord can be 000. And once we place a retraction cord, we displace the gingiva apically. So in that way, our subgingival margin becomes supragingival. And it's easier for us to give a subgingival margin, which after retraction will now show us as supragingival. So after we remove the retraction cord, again our margin will go subgingivally. So it is always good to prepare the margin in the cervical region after placing a retraction cord. So after we have given margin for our veneer, now we'll go for a proximal preparation. Now, proximal preparation of a ceramic veneer can also be of two types. It can be a wing margin or you can give a slice preparation. So in this picture, as we see here, the incisor in the proximal region extends slightly above the contact area here between the cemento enamel junction and the contact. This is the elbow portion of the veneer. Why we give this elbow is because we do not want to see the junction of the natural tooth and enamel through the sagittal view. So therefore, we give a elbow portion here and we give a wing margin. That is, we just continue the chamfer that we have given in the cervical region. We just continue it through the proximal area. So this wing proximal margin is given when the tooth contact is intact. The second type of proximal preparation is called slice preparation. Slice preparation, we need not give a wing as we had given before when the contact was intact. So slice preparation is given when there is diastema present between two teeth. So in this case, there is no need to give a wing preparation because unnecessarily there's no need to remove any enamel over there because already there is enough enamel and there is sufficient space between the two teeth. So when diastema is present, we just extend this chamfer and just blend it with the proximal surface. We just flatten out the proximal surface. So here you can see that the veneer will extend throughout the proximal surface. What happens here is that we create a space where the ceramist has sufficient amount of space available for him to build the ceramic from lingual to the labial aspect. And we can give slice proximal preparation also in such cases where we have subcontact papillary defect, as you can see here. In this case, if we do not break the contact and when we make impression and retrieve the impression, we are going to tear the impression in that region, because the impression that is stuck in this region is not going to come out. So in this case, we have to break the contact aggressively like this so that the impression can retrieve out safely. So when we do a slice preparation, this helps us to just cover the dark area that is seen inside the mouth. Because if we give a wing, as in this case, the ceramist cannot add the ceramic in this part, the proximal part. So what happens is the dark area inside the mouth will show through that. So it will look like a dark triangle, which will be unesthetic. So there's a controversy regarding whether we should break the contact or not in case of a proximal preparation. So there are a lot of advantages of breaking the contacts. One advantage is that it helps us to prepare dye, because if the technician has to prepare a dye, he has to cut the cast arbitrarily. If there is a contact that is broken, the dye can be prepared more easily, and thus it will not damage the margins also. And it will also facilitate a more positive seating of the veneer, which means that there are less chances of discrepancy as the dye has been prepared accurately. And also there is a reduced likelihood of tearing the impression, because the impression can be retrieved out safely. And there is no chance of bonding the veneer to the adjacent tooth also, since there is a gap present between the two teeth. Now, when in cases where we have given wing and there is a tight contact, in that case also we can use a interproximal strip of 0.5 millimeter to just create a small space between the two teeth, just to help the technician in making a proper dye. And it will also help in reducing or minimizing the discrepancy. In this case, we need not do aggressive cutting. We need not break the contact points aggressively. We can just use an interproximal strip to create a small gap of 0.5 millimeter. This will also help to make a veneer with less discrepancy and proper fit. Now, once we've prepared the tooth, next step is finishing and polishing. This is also very important, because we know ceramic is a glass which needs to be bonded on a smooth surface. So there should not be any roughness present on the surface, because you know glass rough surface helps in crack propagation. So we can use Soflex disc, or we can use Eve polisher as mentioned earlier, so that we see that there is no rough surface on the tooth, and also that all the line angles have been rounded off to minimize stress concentration. And after we've completed our tooth preparation, we'll see if we have exposed any dentin on the labial surface. In that case, we'll apply a system desensitizer to minimize sensitivity in the patient. So this system desensitizer only needs to be rubbed onto the exposed dentin for 20 seconds. There's no need to cure this. Then we'll make final impression. I prefer a one-step impression with heavy body and light body impression material. And this gives a proper impression. After this, before we send the impression to the lab, we also need to give the stump shade to the technician. Because if we do not select the stump shade, the preparation is not going to be, the restoration is not going to be successful. Because as we know, the veneer is a very, very thin restoration. And if the stump shade is dark, it is going to show through the veneer. And then the prepared veneer is not going to match with the adjacent tooth. So it's a failure of the treatment. So it is very important for the technician to know the shade of the tooth before preparation and also to know the stump shade, so that he can properly mask the discoloration. And when we select the shade, it is important that we take photograph of also of the stump shades with the tooth. Because in this case, as you can see, the shade is mentioned along with the photograph. So through the photograph also, the technician can judge the relative darkness or lightness. That is the value of the tooth, the shade of the veneer that he wants to give. So the technician will also have a fair amount of idea. If we just keep 2-3 shades for him to as a reference along with the photograph of the tooth. Then we begin temporization. For temporization, it is preferred that you use ProTemp plus bisacryl material because it's faster. The temporary will bond to the tooth structure. But we will not use bonding agent here. We will just spot etch the tooth in the middle portion. And after this, we can use a flowable composite to just place the temporary in the mouth so that the patient can go home till the veneer is prepared. So here, the temporaries are placed now in the patient's mouth. The patient can see whether he is happy with the final out, like how the final restoration will look like. And it is important to take photographs at this stage also. And this can also be sent to the technician. So after the technician has made the veneer and his veneer are now ready, now we'll call the patient for trials and the bonding appointment. So the trial and bonding appointment consists of 3 steps. First is temporary removal. Second is we'll do trial. And third is bonding. So during temporary removal, we'll just cut slit through the labial and the incisal portion of the temporary, and we'll use an instrument to just twist and crack the temporary and cut it through the tooth. We'll have to make sure that we do not damage any prepared tooth structure, and any remaining cement or bisacral material, temporary material needs to be removed. So we have to use floss also and make sure that the surface is extremely clean. After this, we'll start trial of the veneer. So trial also consists of a dry trial and a wet trial. So dry trial, we'll first try individual teeth. That is, individual veneer will be tested in the patient's mouth, whether it has proper fit or not. After testing individual veneers for fit, we'll place all the veneers together and see how it fits in the mouth, whether all can fit together as well. So in this case, after we've done a try-in for single veneer and the fit was good, now when we place all the veneers are not fitting. This clearly implies that there is some amount of discrepancy in the proximal surface. So we'll just put an articulating paper here, 40 micron, and we can slowly pull it out. So the mark here shows us that there was a discrepancy in the proximal surface. That's why all the veneers were not fitting together. So this needs to be removed only through yellow grit burr, diamond burr. And then any roughness created needs to be polished through Eve polisher. So till this stage, the patient has not seen his final restoration. So now to show the patient how it will finally look in the mouth, we'll start the wet trial. Wet trial is for the aesthetic evaluation. Dry trial was to check the fit. Now to do wet trial, there are Variolink and Trine paste available. If you do not want to buy that, we can try using lubricating gel, Lubic as well, because it creates a viscosity and helps in retention of the veneer in the patient's mouth, so that patient can give approval for that. So once the patient is happy after the wet trial, we'll start the bonding procedure. So bonding procedure requires proper isolation. We can either use Optra gate or Optra dam. We can use split dam or we can use individual teeth isolation. It's up to the dentist. And before bonding, we'll have to prepare the veneer side and the tooth side. So it is better to prepare the veneer side first because the patient doesn't have to wait for that long. Okay, so the patient, after removing the temporary, we'll make the patient sit and we'll prepare the veneer side first. So the veneer will be placed. It's easier if it you can place it on a cheap lab putty. So that, because veneers are very thin, it's only 0.5 millimeter. If you do not feel comfortable holding it in your hands, it's better to put it in this putty and it will make it easier to hold. So then we begin the bonding protocol. As we all are very familiar, we get it through manufacturer instructions also along with the resin cement. We have to clean thoroughly by rubbing alcohol onto the veneer. If sandblast is possible, we can sandblast it. Most of the veneers are sent to us after etching with hydrofluoric acid. So if not, we can etch it with hydrofluoric acid for 20 seconds for Emax and 1.5 minute for Lucite. Then again, we have to wash it and completely dry it, then apply silane coupling agent and again dry it. So now we have completed our preparation on the veneer side. So now we'll prepare the tooth for bonding. So to prepare the tooth for bonding, after we've removed temporarily, we'll thoroughly clean the surface with the prophylaxis paste. So you can use Profit prophylaxis paste here because the paste needs to be fluoride free. So once temporaries are removed and cleaned properly, then we follow the bonding protocol on the tooth side. So we etch the tooth with 37% phosphoric acid, wash thoroughly, apply bonding agent. We can blow dry it. We should blow dry it with 20 seconds to, so that we can ensure that the vehicle is gone and there is no pooling of the bonding agent, which will prevent the proper seating of the veneer. So at this stage, you can cure it or you can just leave it by just drying and making sure that there is a uniform layer of bonding agent on the labial surface. Now we can load the prepared veneer with light cure resin cement. And I prefer light cure than dual cure because light cure gives us more time for bonding. Because when you're just starting with your veneer cases, it's better to have more time. So light cure resin cement gives us more time. So we'll just cure it for 2 seconds first on each surface. This is called a tack cure. So this is a light cure resin cement we have from Variolink. So this helps in because light cure is enough in this case because veneer is only 0.5 millimeter thick. So light cure resin gives us time and also gives us good aesthetics. So then we start with bonding. So bonding, we have to load the veneer with the cement. And as shown in this picture, it's tack cured first so that we can remove the excess. So once we tack cure, the cement becomes jelly consistency and it's easier to remove it. And after all the excess has been removed, we can finally cure it. And it's also important to remove the set resin cement from the interproximal region, because the flash will not be visible through the eye. So it is important to remove if there is any excess present in the interproximal area through a number 12 burr. So thus we can finally give the veneer restoration to the patient. So I hope this, thank you. I hope this webinar was useful.
Dr. Ravi?
Hello, sir. Can you hear me?
Any doubts?
Hello.
Hello.
Dr. Sangeeta, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Actually, thank you for the presentation. It was a good presentation, even though we had some technical issues, but it was made up at the end. I hope it is. The participants are clear about the use of porcelain veneers and how to do it. Doctor, we have a few questions. Can I move on to the questions?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. There was a doubt by one of our participants that why is it necessary to break the contact always?
Hello?
Well, why is it necessary to break the contacts while preparing the tooth?
Yeah, there are two schools of thought in this regard. That one says that it is not necessary to break the contact. And in that case, what happens is, if when we do not break the contact and send the impression to the technician, he'll pour the cast. And when he will prepare the die, he is going to arbitrarily cut through the cast, right? He is going to arbitrarily cut through the master cast in order to make individual dies. And he'll just randomly make a veneer preparation, which he'll send it to us for trying in the patient. So there are chances that it will not fit properly in the mouth because the proximal contact has not been cut. So there are more chances of discrepancy in this case. And even if the veneer fits in the patient's mouth, it's not going to be a passive fit. So when we break the contact, it's easier to make die for the technician. It's easier for him to prepare. It's easier for him to prepare a proper veneer without much discrepancy, as the margins, nothing will be damaged. If anybody has done a die preparation, I'm sure they'll understand. Or if they've seen a die. So in case when we are giving a wing preparation in the proximal region, it is not necessary that we vigorously break the contact. It's only 0.5 mm contact that is recommended by the technicians, that if we just use an interproximal strip also, it makes easier for them to prepare a die and give us a veneer with more accurate fit. And other advantages also, as I mentioned, are very important. When you prepare the contact, the impression is easier to retrieve. You will not bond the veneer to the adjacent tooth. So the main advantage is that it helps the technician to make die and give us a more accurate veneer, which will properly fit in the patient's mouth. I hope I've answered the question.
I hope it is clear for the participant.
Yes.
Doctor, for the next question, is it always better to use the upper channel hearing?
Is it always better to use
EMAX for anterior veneers?
Yeah. EMAX is, I think it's the most preferred material because it is lithium disilicate and it is now, it is made from monolithic. It's a monolithic material. So that makes it very, very durable. It is very, very strong. So it is preferred. We have IPS, EMAX, Press, CAD. So the strong longevity is good and aesthetics is also very good because of good translucency. So EMAX is better.
Is there any cost difference for this, doctor? If not EMAX, which one would be better financially also?
Otherwise, you could go for leucite-based or feldspathic porcelain. But I feel strength-wise, EMAX is always better, because you don't want to risk your restoration after the patient has paid so much for veneer.
Okay, if you have decided for porcelain veneers, then it is better to go for EMAX.
Better to go for EMAX, as most clinicians agree on that EMAX gives both strength and aesthetics.
Durability, right. Okay, doctor, the next question is, what would be the sequence of placing the veneers for the anteriors?
Sequence of placing the veneers.
Yeah.
Once you have done a dry trial with individual veneer, you can, the importance of breaking the contacts are also very clearly seen. Because once you break the contacts, when you place the veneers, the seating issue will not be there. So when you place the veneer, after you check the individual fit, then you can check all the veneers. You can follow any sequence. If there is no discrepancy, then you can go ahead with the wet trial. If there is discrepancy and you feel any of the veneer is not fitting properly, you can check it through an articulating paper, 40 micron, as was mentioned. So I don't feel the all the veneers will not fit properly if you have given space for the technician to do a proper dye preparation. All the veneers will fit perfectly. And if they do not fit, you can just check the proximal contact. After you've checked all the veneers individually, you can check all the veneers together and see with the articulating paper where it is where there is discrepancy. You can just trim it off with yellow grid work.
Okay, I hope it is clear. Doctor, can we use veneers for cervical abrasion cases?
Cervical abrasion cases will not have enamel in the cervical region. So in that cases, if it is a deep cervical abrasion, it's better to go for a crown. Because if you cannot give a predictable bonding, then it's better to go for a crown.
If you have a cervical abrasion, it's better to go for a
yeah,
crown.
Yeah, if the cervical abrasion is very severe and you feel there is no enamel, for a proper bonding, longevity depends upon the amount of enamel that is present. If there is cervical abrasion, probably the amount of enamel on the labial surface will also be less. And if you feel that bonding will not be proper because there's no adequate enamel present, it's better to go for crown in that case.
It's good to go for crown. Yeah. Okay, doctor. Doctor, the next question is, should there be any change in depth of preparation for the tooth depending upon its intensity of discoloration?
Yeah, if the discoloration is more, we'll need more thickness of material to hide the discoloration. So if the discoloration more, the preparation needs to be deeper. But we have to keep in mind that we need the enamel also. So we have to do proper case selection in that case. So discoloration, if you give the stump shade to the technician, he can mask the discoloration to a great extent. But the basic thing is that we should always keep in mind that our restoration should bond to the enamel, not to the dentin.
Right. Okay, I hope it is clear. Doctor, the template and the mock, which yes. You told is a necessary step in porcelain veneer. These stages are made in the lab or it can be done?
The technician knows how to do. Yeah, he knows how to do. So once you've made a diagnostic cast, you can yourself check whether this case will go for an additive mock-up or whether it will go for a subtractive mock-up. So as I said, in all the steps, we need to take photograph before preparing the tooth, after preparing the tooth with the temporaries. So it is very important that you keep the case in your mind, that you should discuss with the technician after deciding whether it's a case for additive mock-up or subtractive mock-up. You should dictate it to the technician by telling him you can trim the cast and make a mock-up, or you need not trim a cast because the tooth is that I'm going to give veneer is already lingually placed. So I'm not going to cut any enamel. Much of enamel. So you can directly do wax up and make mock in the lab. So that communication, I mean, you have to give instruction to the dental technician and he will make the putty index as you asked. And if he has done any tooth reduction, he will mark it in the cast and he will inform you so that you can remove the, if it's a subtractive case, so that you can also remove the same amount of tooth structure in the patient's mouth. Only then the putty index that is sent from the lab will fit in the mouth. Only then you can give temporaries to the patient. So the technician can make a template and mock.
It's better to be done in the lab itself.
It's better to be done in the lab. Because with that temporaries, when you take picture in the patient's mouth, the technician can see, he can also see how it will look in the mouth. So it's better that you give it to the technician.
Okay, doctor. The next question is, does veneer work well in high frenum cases?
Yeah, frenum cases has, I don't think any has any issues with veneer. Only thing is that high lip line, you have to be careful about the gingival architecture. If high frenum has, he has issues with gingival problems or he has periodontal problem, then it's better to correct it before you go for veneer. So if he has gingivitis or he has uneven gingival architecture and he has high lip line, so when he smiles, no matter how good veneer you've given, it doesn't look good. So in that cases, it's better to correct the gingival, the call a periodontist and correct all that before you go for veneer. If it's a low lip line case, then it doesn't matter because anyways, margins will not be visible. Like in lower incisors, you can easily hide whatever, even if the gingival architecture is not proper.
Okay, Dr. Sangeeta. The last, I think it's the next one. This is the last question. What is the post-cementation instructions that you give to the patient?
The bonding cement that we have used is very good because this is this has so far, if you have bonded it properly, you have followed all the protocols and you have bonded your veneer on the enamel, then this complex of tooth and veneer complex is so strong that you don't have to give any particular instruction to the patient, because once you made sure that you removed all the excess cement. As I had showed in the slide, with a number 12 BP blade, you can check if there is any flash of cement in the interproximal region. Once you have corrected all this, I don't think there is any special instruction that needs to be followed. But you have to check that before doing the preparation, it is very important for you to check the bite. So the bite, if it's an edge-to-edge bite, in that case, you should go for a lingual wrap so that the contact of the veneer and the junction of the veneer and the tooth doesn't come in the functional contact area. So once you've done a proper case selection and you've done followed a proper bonding protocol, this material is so good that it's like a ceramic tile. It won't stain. And if it's bonded properly, it won't come out also. So this is a very good restoration. So you don't have to give any particular instruction to take care of the restoration. Yes, he can maintain a good oral hygiene. Otherwise, the bonding, if it's done in the enamel, I don't think there will be any issues with the case.
Okay, Dr. Sangeeta. So we come to the end of the question session. Simon, sir.